In modern Christianity, there exists a very sharp divide between those who will only accept a literal interpretation of the Bible.
As long as you understand the Bible as revelation intended to be understood, that you believe in the perspicuity of Scripture. In other words, this is not mysticism, this is not fantasy, this is not some kind of allegory.
And those who will only accept an allegorical interpretation of the Bible.
It says, if we take away the idea of having an actual historical Adam and an actual fall, hence taking away the idea of original sin, then what is the purpose of Jesus coming and dying on the cross?
The great irony is that the literal group doesn't understand the Bible literally, and the allegorical group doesn't understand the Bible allegorically. As funny as this may be, it's no real surprise, because the truth of the matter is, it's very difficult to fully possess one without the other. You may be surprised to learn this, but the early Christians all read the Bible believing that both the literal and the figurative interpretations were both fundamentally true at the same time. So the purpose of this video is to look at the second book of Moses called Exodus, chapters 1 through 17, through the symbolic lens of the early Christians. Now, you may be wondering what the point of only exploring the symbolic interpretation is when I had just previously explained that both the literal and the symbolic were simultaneously true. Well, if you know the stories of the Old Testament, then yes, that is of course a very good thing. But if you never ascend beyond the simple, literal understanding of the texts, then you have limited the Old Testament to mere Jewish fables for yourself. You haven't walked with Christ up that high mountain and there discovered in the midst of the law and the prophets the full glory of Christ transfigured. But don't you remember near the end of Luke's respective gospel when it states that Christ revealed himself in the entirety of the works of Moses and the prophets? Don't you remember when Christ told the Jews that what happened to Jonah, being swallowed up in the fish for 3 days and three nights, was ordained by God as a sign of what would later happen to Christ himself? We know that the letter kills, but it's the Spirit that gives life. As Christians, the Old Testament is much more than just a history book for us, but it was written for our edification and discipline. To the Christian, the Old Testament can be just as valuable as the New Testament. Just as Christ said, every scribe who has become a disciple of the kingdom of heaven is like a head of a household who brings out of his treasure new things and old. And we should also not forget what Paul said while in the Spirit to the Corinthians. Moses used to put a veil over his face so that the sons of Israel would not stare at the end of what was fading away. But their minds were hardened. For until this very day, at the reading of the Old Covenant, the same veil remains unlifted, because it is removed in Christ. But to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. So then, let's turn our hearts to the Lord and pray that he gives us heavenly wisdom when reading the books of Moses, removing the veil and instead revealing the full glory of Christ. Amen.
Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. Tell
Moses begins the book of Exodus by stating that the children of Israel were going to make their way to Egypt, but Joseph was already at this time in Egypt before them. And immediately, there's already a hidden prophecy here just waiting to be discovered. The sons of Israel, that is the Jews, hating Joseph their brother, who is a type of Christ, had rejected him and removed him from their presence by force, sending him away from the land of their fathers to a foreign country, Egypt, where the Gentiles lived. Joseph, being rejected by his own brothers, made himself a blessing to the Gentiles instead. Later in time, as the sons of Israel began to regret their rejection of Joseph, recognizing the good he did for another people, finally make their journey to go and join Joseph in Egypt. They settle in the land of Goshen, which is said to translate as to draw near or to approach. Now, if we're brave enough to look beyond the simple letter of the law and instead search for the spirit of the law, we will discover that this alludes to Israel's future restoration. When they will finally approach the Lord they had previously rejected, the same Lord who has been Lord to the Gentiles. Just as Christ says, they will realize that I have loved you. And as John also says, every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. This is the hidden meaning of when the text says, but Joseph was already in Egypt. Now it was the Apostle Paul, who was the teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth, that taught the Gentile church how they should interpret the Old Testament. He's known to give many examples of allegorical interpretation of the Old Testament.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
And he did this to prevent our minds from thinking carnally, and so that we wouldn't be ensnared by the letter as the Jews were. Disciples of Christ are distinguished by disciples of the synagogue by the way they understand the law. The Jews, by misunderstanding it, rejected Christ, but we, as Christians, by understanding the law spiritually, show that it was wisely given for the instruction and edification of the church. So when the Jews read, they only understand that Joseph died and all his brothers and all that generation, but the sons of Israel increased and were multiplied and were extended into a great multitude and became very strong, for the land multiplied them. But we, rather, as Christians who understand the law spiritually, understand the deeper and prophetic implications of the law. While Joseph was still alive in the flesh, it isn't reported that the sons of Israel were multiplied, nor is anything at all mentioned about increases in multitudes in these times. I, believing in the words of my Lord, do not think that one iota or one point in the law and prophets is void of mysteries. The sons of Israel were very few before our Joseph died, but when he tasted death for all, by which he destroyed him who had the rule of death, that is the devil, then the people of faith were multiplied, and the sons of Israel were extended, and the land multiplied them, and they increased exceedingly beyond measure. Unless, as Christ explained, a grain of wheat hadn't fallen into the earth and died, the church would certainly not have produced this huge harvest across the whole earth. Once the grain fell into the earth and died, then this whole crop of the faithful arose from it, and the sons of Israel were multiplied and became very strong, so that the voice of the apostles went out into all the earth, and their words to the ends of the earth. And through them, as it is written, the word of the Lord increased and multiplied. I can't stress enough how important it is to understand that these words weren't written by Moses to only instruct us in history, but more importantly, to instruct us and admonish us in regard to spiritual truths and righteous living. As Paul tells us, these things happened as an example for our sake.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
But then a new king rose up in Egypt who didn't know Joseph. And he said to his people, "The people of the sons of Israel are too many and too mighty for us." Now, who is the king of Egypt that doesn't know Joseph and fears the human race as a potential enemy? Who is the king of Egypt that cunningly schemes to trap the human race in bondage to him? The king of Egypt, throughout the text of Exodus, serves as an allegory to Satan. I do believe that it is for this reason that the Pharaoh is never named, because there were actually multiple pharaohs throughout this entire event. But it's almost written in such a way as to give the impression that we are really observing the actions of a single person. And that's because we are, in an allegorical sense, that is. the actions of the devil, specifically, who is said to be the god of this world. And the Pharaoh, who is the devil, addresses his people, who are the apostate angels, and says to them, "The race of the sons of Israel is a great multitude and is stronger than us. Let's restrain them, otherwise they increase, and when war breaks out, they side with our adversaries, and overcoming us, they leave our land." We shouldn't be afraid of Satan, because Satan is evidently afraid of us. Satan's plan could be compared to a man who kills the bear when the bear is still only a cub, knowing full well what the bear will grow up to be, which is a large and powerful creature. Satan, recognizing that humanity is actually in its infancy and not yet a complete threat to him, desires to spiritually kill us while we're still infants so that it's impossible for us to become the adversaries we are destined to be. Now, Satan's fear of a future war seems to indicate that he perceived beforehand what had been disclosed from time to time about the advent of Christ by the holy patriarchs or prophets, and from this is aware of the threat of future war. He perceives that Christ, who is the one that despoils his principalities and powers and with confidence conquers them and fastens them to the wood of his cross, is approaching him to defeat him. So Satan desires to restrain and limit the rational sense in men, which now is figuratively called Israel. Then he sets taskmasters over them to compel them to learn works of the flesh, as it also says in the Psalms, "And they were mingled among the heathens and learned their works." He also teaches them to build three cities for himself: Pithom, which has been translated Mouth of Rebellion, and Ramesses, as it's written in the text, is translated by Origen, the great scholar and master of language, as Commotion of a Moth. And On, that is Heliopolis, which is called City of the Sun. Now, do you see what kind of cities Pharaoh commands to be built for himself? Mouth of Rebellion, as it's translated, because he was a liar from the beginning, the father of all lies. And so, he wishes such cities to be built for himself. And another one of his cities is translated as the Commotion of a Moth. Satan and his followers are best compared to moths. They're creatures with an intense attraction to the flames of hell. And the third city, which was Heliopolis, translated as the City of the Sun, and they built it for him with a false name because he changes himself to appear as an angel of light. By these means he hinders, by these means he seizes the minds which were made to see God. Satan lies to you with his rebellious mouth, deceiving you into believing he's an angel of light for the purpose of turning you into a moth destined for the flames. Now, from my own research into the etymology of the name Ramesses, I haven't yet discovered a connection to moths. I have to assume that Origen, who most definitely had a more profound knowledge of the language than I ever will, possessed certain information that I unfortunately lack. But I will say that from my own studying, it seems that the name Ramesses means to be born of Ra. Now, the name of the Egyptian deity Ra and the word for evil are in fact one and the same in the Hebrew language. So, the names of the cities can also be understood in another way, that is, if you obey Satan's mouth, his tongue being in constant rebellion to God, doing his bidding and building up his cities by committing evil, then you will be Ra's son, and he will be your father, and you'll be a stranger to God because you live in Satan's kingdom and not in the kingdom of heaven. It's just as Christ rebuked the Jews in the gospel, saying, "You are of your father, the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father, son of Ra, son of evil." But again, Satan perceives from the words of the prophets that future war is coming for him, and that he will be abandoned by the sons of Israel, that they'll instead side with his adversary and be added to the Lord. This is what the prophet Jeremiah had predicted about him when he said, "As the partridge has cried out, she has gathered a brood, not her own. So is he who has made his wealth unjustly. In the midst of his days, his wealth shall leave him, and in his last days, he shall be a fool." Satan understands that he will be left a fool in his last days, when the whole creation, which currently groans by virtue of his tyranny, will finally take refuge with its maker and parent. And so he's indignant at this, and he says, "After they conquer us, they will depart from our land." So you see, Satan doesn't want us to leave his land, but wants us to always bear the image of the earthly. If we do take refuge with his opponent, the one who prepared the kingdom of heaven for us, we must leave the image of the earthly and receive the image of the heavenly. If for that reason, Pharaoh appoints taskmasters to teach us their skills, to tutor us in every manner of evil. The mud and brick Satan afflicts humanity with is sin, and he instructs us to build the very walls which separate us from God and keep us trapped in Egypt and in slavery to him. But of course, it didn't satisfy Satan to simply afflict the human race with sin, just as Pharaoh afflicted the Israelites with mud and brick. But there was even a desire to require the death of the male Israelite infants, but to leave the female Israelite infants untouched. It was the male Israelite infants that would develop and later reproduce more Israelite offspring with the female Israelites. You see, Satan takes more pleasure in corrupting the good than he does in simply destroying the good. And it was for this reason that he didn't have all the infants killed, but only the males. Satan doesn't merely desire for you to do evil, but to also take away the good that you have. If Israel were to be understood allegorically as a single person, then the offspring would be the increase of that man's moral character. Christ's desire for us is to perform good works that far surpass our previous good works, correct? Well, then it follows that Satan's desire for us is to perform evil works that far surpass our previous evil works. If Satan requested the death of all infants, both male and female, then the race of the Israelites would become extinct, and the man which Israel is symbolic of would be dead. And this isn't Satan's ultimate desire. Satan wanted the females left alive, so that the Israelites would still continue to exist, but would soon become corrupt. His plan being to destroy the male and rational offspring of the soul in the flood of the passions, while he takes delight in seeing the carnal and more sensual offspring increase and multiply. Now, Pharaoh approaches the midwives to help him accomplish his plan for genocide, but they fear God and directly disobey him. Moses, being inspired by God, only mentions there being two midwives named Shiphrah and Puah. Now, no doubt, practically speaking, Pharaoh would have required the help of far more than two midwives to accomplish this plan. So why did Moses choose to make mention of two specifically? Moses has two logical options to choose from here. Name all the midwives Pharaoh spoke with for the sake of history, or name none of the midwives for the sake of time. But Moses doesn't choose either of these. Instead, Moses chooses to only mention a total of two midwives. And this must be because the two midwives are symbolic of the two testaments of God, the Old and the New. The very purpose of a midwife as a profession is to assist the woman who gives birth and ensure the successful birth of a child. The mother who is giving birth could be understood as the church, or more specifically the teacher who labors over a convert, and the midwives are to be understood as the two testaments that are there to assist us in this endeavor and instruct us on how to successfully give birth to children. Just as scripture assists us in making converts and instructs us on how to increase in moral character. And notice that the text doesn't simply call them midwives, but specifically Hebrew midwives. Because scripture only sets out to assist the birth of Hebrew offspring, not the births of the Egyptian offspring. If you take the time to look into the meanings and etymology of the names of the two midwives, you'll find that the name Pua can be translated as radiant mouth, and Shifra as peaceful sky. Pua seems to be symbolic of the Old Testament, in my opinion, which is characterized by the way in which it radiantly speaks of the coming of Christ. Shifra, on the other hand, seems to be symbolic of the New Covenant, which is characterized by its plea for all men to make peace with heaven, just as Paul commands us, saying, "Let us have peace." The text then says, "A woman from the tribe of Levi who bore a male child and saw him to be a fine child hid him for 3 months." And this was written for our sake as Christians, that we should know to avoid performing our good deeds in public, not practicing righteousness before men, but instead, after the door has been shut, we might pray to our Father in secret, and that the left hand might not know what our right hand does. Because unless our good deed is done in secret, it will certainly be plundered by the Egyptians. It will be attacked, and it will be thrown into the river. It will be submerged by waves and floods. But naturally, a person who only performs good deeds can only keep it a secret for so long, just like a parent can only keep an infant hidden for a certain amount of time before they're discovered, and once discovered, persecuted for the sake of righteousness. The text goes on to say, "When they were not able to hide him any longer, his mother took a basket and smeared it with bitumen and placed the child in it and put him in the marsh along the river. And his sister watched from a distance to see what would happen to him. Now Pharaoh's daughter descended to bathe in the river and heard the child crying. She sent and took him up. And Pharaoh's daughter said, 'This is one of the Hebrew children.' What then follows relates how his sister said that she would call the boy's mother to nurse him. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Keep this child for me and nurse him for me, and I will pay you.' And when she had nursed him and he grew stronger, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter and he became her son. And she called his name Moses, saying, 'I took you up from the water.'" Each of these statements is filled with great mysteries and demands so much time. Even if we spent an entire day on this passage alone, it wouldn't be sufficient. Nevertheless, we must at least briefly touch on some things here for the sake of edification. Now, Pharaoh's daughter can be regarded as the church, which is gathered from the Gentiles. Although she's the daughter of an impious and hostile father, nevertheless, the prophet says to her, "Hear, daughter, and incline your ear. Forget your people and the house of your father, because the king has desired your beauty." So, this is the daughter who leaves her father's house and comes to the waters to be washed from the sins which she had contracted in her father's house. And then she immediately experiences deeply felt compassion and pities the child. This church coming from the Gentiles finds Moses in the marsh, lying cast off by his own people and exposed, and gives him out to be reared. So he's reared by his own family and spends his infancy there. But when he has grown stronger, he is brought to her and adopted as a son. Now Moses can be understood in most places as a symbol of the law itself. So the church, coming to the waters of baptism, also took up the law. The law, however, had been enclosed in a basket and smeared with pitch and bitumen. The basket is a kind of covering woven together from twigs or papyrus, or even formed from the bark of trees. The infant placed within this basket was seen exposed. The law was found lying helpless, enclosed in coverings of this kind, besmeared with pitch and bitumen. It was dirty and enclosed in the cheap and offensive interpretations of the Jews, until the church would come from the Gentiles and take it up from the muddy and marshy places and appropriate it to itself within the courts of wisdom and royal houses. But the law, which is Moses, spends its childhood with its own people, with those who aren't able to understand it spiritually. It's little and infantile and has milk as its food.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
But when Moses comes to the church, when he enters the house of the church, he grows stronger and more robust. when the veil of the letter is removed, perfect and solid food is discovered in its text. But let's also take up the law of God to ourselves when we approach the waters, even if we did have Pharaoh as our father, even if the prince of this world begot us in evil works. We won't allow its cheap and obscure cover of the letter be despised by us. Let's give up what is small and milky. Let's take up what is perfect and robust, and let's set these up within the royal dwellings of our heart. Let's allow Moses to grow up large and strong. Let's not think anything small or anything lowly about him, but let him be totally magnificent, totally distinguished, totally elegant. Whatever is spiritual, whatever is of elevated understanding, is great in every respect. And let's pray to our Lord that he might reveal and show us in what manner Moses is great and elevated, because he reveals it to whom he wishes by the Holy Spirit. Now it came about in those days, when Moses had grown up, that he went out to his fellow Hebrews and looked at their hard labors. And he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his fellow Hebrews. So he looked this way and that, and when he saw that there was no one around, he struck and killed the Egyptian, and he hid his body in the sand. When Moses, who is understood to be the law, has finally matured, he first looks both ways before killing the Egyptian who is in the process of attacking the Israelite, just as Christ commands us when he says, "Don't do works to be seen by men." Now, in every man exists a struggle between good and evil. Within every person, an Egyptian and an Israelite are fighting. As Paul says, "I joyfully agree with the law of God in the inner person, but I see a different law in the parts of my body, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me a prisoner of the law of sin, and the law which is in my body's parts." And so Moses desires to come to the aid of the Israelite and kill the hostile Egyptian. He then buries the body of the Egyptian, and it says that he specifically buries him in the sand. God says through his prophet Jeremiah, "I made the sand as a border to the sea." And so Moses is seen here to be burying dead works in the sandy shores before the sea of baptism. But before Moses arrives at the well for washing of regeneration, a problem occurs. The text says, "Moses went out the next day, and two Hebrews were fighting with each other. So Moses said to the offender, 'Why are you striking your companion?' But he said, 'Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?' Then Moses was afraid and said, 'Surely the matter has become known.' When Pharaoh heard about this matter, he tried to kill Moses. But Moses fled from his presence and settled in the land of Midian, and he sat down by a well." Now, make sure to take notice of the fact here that the text isn't describing two guilty parties when it tells us that Moses found two Hebrews fighting with one another, because although it says they were both fighting each other, it clarifies that only one party was actually guilty in this altercation. When it says Moses rebuked the offender, it doesn't say that Moses rebuked both of them for fighting, but that he only rebuked the offender when he asked, "Why are you striking your companion?" Which is much like what Christ said to Paul when he asked, "Why do you persecute me?" The two Hebrews that were in conflict were the Jews and Christ, because they, like Joseph's siblings, persecuted their brother who was Christ. Although Christ was a fellow Israelite, he was still attacked by his own. And it's Moses who delivers the rebuke to the offender, just as Christ says, "Don't think that I'll be the one to accuse you before the Father. The one who accuses you is Moses, in whom you've put your hope." Now the Jews are very indignant at this, and they retort to Moses, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" Christ correspondingly states in the Gospel, "If you really did believe Moses, then you would have believed me, because he wrote about me." The Jews honor Moses with their lips, but their hearts are very far from him, because if they had any legitimate respect for Moses, they would have respected the Christ that he predicted would eventually come into the world. But this is the moment that Paul describes as the natural branches being broken off, when the Israelite says, "Do you intend to kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" And then the text describes that this caused Moses to fear for his own self-preservation, because now that the natural branches have been broken off, Pharaoh intends to kill Moses. And this can be understood as follows: that Satan expected a final victory for himself against God and his word in the Jews' rejection of Christ, the law, and the prophets. If the Jews no longer believe, no longer respecting Moses, then what's supposed to happen to Moses? Satan hopes that Moses can now once and for all be killed, because no one respects him or has faith in him anymore. Who other than the Jews does Moses even have? But as Paul states, after the natural branches were broken off, then the Gentiles, being a wild olive, were grafted in among them. So Moses, in order to remain alive, has to abandon the Jews for another people. Moses goes to live in the land called Midian, which translates as the sons of Abraham, because although Moses would find himself surrounded by foreigners according to the flesh, these would prove to be the true sons of Abraham. Just as John the Baptist says to the Jews, "Don't assume that you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that God is able from these very stones to raise up children for Abraham, and the axe is already laid at the root of the tree." And just as Paul also says to the Galatians, "If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendants, heirs according to promise." Now, relocating to Midian, the first thing Moses does is rest by a well. Just as Christ says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Now, if we mourn over our sins, just as Moses buried the dead Egyptian in the sand, then we can expect to be comforted by the washing of regeneration in the great sea of baptism. Here at this well, which Moses finds rest in, he also meets the woman who would become his wife, just as Christ finds his wife, the church, through the sacrament of baptism. And Moses is not the only one who found his wife at a well, but also Isaac and Jacob found their respective wives at a well too. And each of these instances portray the same underlying truth from a different perspective. But I digress. Later in the text, it states that Moses named his son Gershom because he was a stranger in a strange land. Now, we know this has to have a hidden meaning to it because of the fact that Moses wasn't the first person to have a child in a foreign land. If you can remember, Joseph had children in Egypt, yet he doesn't draw any attention to it. This is because the Gentiles, who had no blood connection to Abraham, would nonetheless become children of Abraham. And even today, Moses lives as a stranger in the foreign lands with the Gentiles. Now, don't let anyone fool you. The Lord never does anything without thought or intention. Anyone who would have you believe that the Lord's appearances throughout the Bible are random and without meaning is a liar. In reality, there's a great mystery behind every appearance of the Lord. For example, the whirlwind which the Lord is said to speak to Job from. After enduring so much conjecture from Job's friends, the text says that the Lord spoke to Job from a whirlwind. Why did the Lord choose to speak from a whirlwind? Well, you have to ask yourself, what is the nature of a whirlwind, if not loudness and chaos? In a chaotic, loud world filled with conjecture, personal opinions, and half-truths, the Lord is in the midst of it all, speaking to us and telling us the one truth. If we locate his voice and ignore the surrounding chaos, then we will hear the truth. And there's a mystery of this kind to be discovered in every single instance of the Lord making an appearance. I would go through all of them, but for the sake of time, we should remain focused on the text of Exodus. And the text tells us, "The angel of the Lord appeared in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush, and the bush itself wasn't consumed by the fire." Now, before we begin to unravel the mystery of this glorious appearance of the Lord, we should take a moment to ensure we are fully comprehending the full picture as it's described by Moses. In the first place, it says, "The angel of the Lord." Now, who is this? The Jews have always taught that this was a mere angel. But this angel of the Lord quickly tells Moses, "I am the God of your fathers." So this cannot be a mere angel. So is it the Father, the unbegotten God? Certainly not. The Father being ineffable and without any form. We know that no one has ever had any direct contact with the Father. It is his only begotten Son who reveals him to us. So who can this possibly be, this angel of the Lord? Well, it is the only begotten Son. Now, don't be troubled at the text referring to him as an angel. Angel simply means messenger as a word, and it is fitting for the Lord to be called at certain times angel, because he's the one who declares whatever we ought to know, and is sent to declare what must be revealed. As the Lord himself says in the Gospel, "Whoever hears me, hears him who sent me." So now that we know that the text here is referring to Christ, the Son of God, we should also notice that it not only says that the burning bush is him, but more specifically it states, "The Lord stood in the midst of the bush." So with this in mind, let's make sure we completely do away with the common image of a small talking twig on fire. The text describes something completely different, that in the mountain there was a bush large enough for the Son of God to dwell in when speaking to Moses. But I digress. The mystery of the burning bush is this. In the first place, just as the Holy Spirit is commonly associated with water, he is also associated with fire. As it says in Acts, the apostles' tongues appeared as fire. And in another place, John the Baptist says, "He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." Now in the second place, the bush itself was a genus of thorns. When man first sinned, he was told by the Lord, "The earth will grow thorns and thistles for you." And in the Proverbs, it stated, "The slothful man's way is like a hedge of thorns." And Christ himself was subjected to the crown of thorns because of the evil deeds we committed. So the fact that the Lord's fire, that is, his Holy Spirit, did not consume the bush's thorns can signify nothing good. The flame, then, is recognized to be the Holy Spirit, and the bush and its thorns represent the hard-hearted Jewish people. This is prophetic of the Jews' future denial of Christ and the Holy Spirit, and that they wouldn't be absolved of sin by Christ. And before moving on, it could be understood simultaneously in another respect, that Christ shines a light on the sins of men, exposing even the thought and intention of all men. Now, if we only look at the letter of the law, then all we will be able to see is God telling Moses how he will free Israelites from Egypt, and doing all of this from a burning bush for some strange reason.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
But if we look at the spirit of the law, then something fantastic and edifying is revealed to us, which is the Lord himself confirming that the ultimate point of this rescue mission is to be understood allegorically as it relates to future events. Judge for yourself. Does God care more about freeing people from slavery to Egypt and Pharaoh, or freeing people from slavery to sin and Satan? And consider all the wonders and miracles the Lord has performed. Why did he perform them in the first place? Every miracle the Lord performed was done for the sake of catching your attention and with the hope of leading your mind to a greater understanding of his purpose for you. Why did he give sight to the blind? Well, to highlight the deeper meaning of his advent, which was to give understanding to the ignorant. We know that Christ cared much more about enlightening the minds of his hearers than he did about literally healing the ears of the deaf. Christ warns his hearers that it's the adulterous generation that requests a sign. Christ then, while appeasing the crowd's desire for a sign, took advantage of the opportunity and the miracle to teach a moral lesson.
So I take the practical stuff myself and try to utilize it and pick out what can work for me.
When you say you don't know what to do with the burning bush, like what do you mean by that?
I don't know what to do on a daily basis with the teaching of and then he showed up as a burning bush, or the magic tricks, and I don't know what to do with, and Jesus healed everyone that and he couldn't walk, and now he touched me and he can walk. I don't know what to do with that.
But today there exists a group of people who would have you believe that to be a spiritual Christian, you should cling to the moral teachings of Christ and disregard the miracles. Take the Jefferson Bible, for example, and this is a foolish position to take. The truly spiritual Christian looks for the hidden meaning of every action, having faith that there is a mystery to be revealed in every action. So then, the appearance of the bush confirms that what is transpiring is taking place for the purpose of allegory above all else. It reveals to the readers that the Jews, although they would soon literally be freed from Egypt and Pharaoh, would not spiritually be freed from sin and Satan as the Christians later would. So we can have faith that all of this didn't occur for the physical well-being of the Jew, but for the instruction and edification of the Christian. So let's pray, as Christians, that this fire does burn in us and consume and annihilate the thorns of our sins. Amen. Now, God here makes a promise to Moses that after he has freed Israel from its bondage to Egypt and Pharaoh, he will lead them to a land flowing with milk and honey. But we know that it wasn't Moses who would bring them into the promised land, but it was Joshua, the man who shares the same name with Christ. It was ordained by God that the first generation of Israelites would not enter the promised land because of their lack of faith. But the second generation was instead ordained by God to enter the promised land under the leadership of Joshua, the successor of Moses. In the same way, Jesus Christ was to introduce the second people, which is composed of us nations, lingering deserted in the world previously, into the land of promise, flowing with milk and honey, which can be understood as Christ's teachings and the gift of eternal life. This had to come about not through Moses, that is, not through the law's discipline, but through Joshua, that is, through the new law's grace. After our circumcision with a knife of rock, that is, with Christ's precepts, because Christ is in many ways and figures predicted as a rock. It was for this reason that the man who was being prepared to act as an image of this sacrament was inaugurated under the figure of the Lord's name, even so as to be named Jesus, or Joshua. At one point, God instructs Moses to place his hand into his bosom. Now, taking it out the first time, the hand is plagued with leprosy, but putting his hand into his bosom again, and taking it out the second time, Moses' hand is unblemished and pure. There is, of course, a mystery in this, just like there's a mystery with everything in the books of Moses. The leprous hand is an instance of God trying to teach us that the second is superior to the first, as he does in so many other places. The first paradise being inferior to the second, Adam being inferior to Christ, Ishmael being inferior to Isaac, Esau being inferior to Jacob, Christ's second advent being greater than his first advent. And of course, the new covenant being superior to the old covenant. So Moses, signifying the law, places his hand, which is used to perform deeds, into his bosom or his core. The first time he draws it out, it is leprous and diseased. But in the second instance, the hand, which again is used to perform deeds, is healthy and without any blemish. The mystery of this miracle seems to be foreshadowing the superiority of the Christian who is living under the new covenant to the Jew who came first living under the old covenant. And then, not much later in the text, does Moses state that he has never been a man of words. Here, Moses mystically alludes to his veil he wore in the presence of the Jewish people, and the veil he still wears symbolically even today. It's no coincidence that Moses was burdened with a speech impediment. In the first place, remembering that Moses is the law, we are taught by this that the law struggles and is limited in its skill to articulate the will of God. Not that the old covenant was evil, but that it didn't fulfill God's standard of righteousness in the same way that the new covenant accomplishes. And further along, in the Lord's response to Moses on this subject, we see another mystery revealed to us. He says, Aaron, who would soon become priest, and speaks very well, is currently seeking Moses, and he will be glad in his heart when he finds him. I believe Aaron here represents the priests who look beyond the simple letter of Moses' books and eagerly seek him out in the hidden places, the spiritual places. And these are the people who delight in finding the spiritual interpretation. Aaron overlooks the speech impediment that burdens Moses and skillfully plucks out the pearls of wisdom hidden in his seemingly simple words. And it came to pass that the angel of the Lord met him by the way in the inn, and sought to slay him. Zipporah took a stone and cut off the foreskin of her son, and fell at his feet, and said, "The blood of the circumcision of my son has ceased." And he departed from him, because she said, "The blood of the circumcision of my son has ceased." Now, the habit of most commentators is to avoid this story at all costs, and you'll scarcely see it depicted in any film adaptation. Not only does it seem to highlight the Lord's wrath to many, but it's a confusing narrative to one who only concerns himself with the letter of the law and not the spirit. However, I repeat myself again, there is a practical reason for the things that happened, and it's no different here. I'll make an exception here and quickly explain the letter in this case, but I'll be sure to avoid devoting too much time to it since the focus of this work is on the spiritual interpretation, which is of course much more edifying than the simple letter. Simply put, God motioned to take their lives because Moses, who had just been gifted with great authority and honor from God, neglected to circumcise his own son. Now, if we already understand that if any Israelite had ever refused to circumcise his son, it would have been a great offense to God, well, then how much more so if it was Moses who refused, who God chose to be the lawgiver? And it was for this reason that God motioned to kill him. But there are things that the letter alone can't explain here. Why did God wait to act this out until they had already arrived at an inn? Why did the Lord only motion to kill Moses, choosing to not strike Moses dead immediately as he did to others before and after this event? What in the world is the significance of Zipporah accomplishing the circumcision of Moses? And why does it say God spared their lives because the blood from the circumcision ceased?
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
Well, in the first place, we know that an inn is a place that's populated by various strangers from foreign lands. Next, the text is vague here on whether the Lord specifically motioned to kill only Moses or Gershom, but the consensus of the early fathers is that the Lord was actually motioning to kill both of them. So we see that the Lord came to the place of the inn, a place that houses strangers from foreign lands, to put to death the stranger from a strange land, which is Gershom. And also the law, which is Moses, on the charge that Moses had failed to circumcise Gershom. At which point the bird, as Zipporah's name translates, intercedes on behalf of Moses to perform a spiritual circumcision on Gershom. Her words and actions are prophetic in that they say, "The bloody circumcision has ceased, and the spiritual circumcision performed by the rock through the spirit has replaced it." And just like the woman who suffered from an issue of blood was cured, the same can be said for Gershom, whose blood from the circumcision ceased. And both of them represented the Gentiles in their own way. So let's make sure, as Christians, that we pray for the Spirit to circumcise our hearts as Zipporah circumcised Gershom, by which means we will narrowly escape the day of wrath. Moving further along, we read in Exodus about how happy the Israelites were when Moses and Aaron had first arrived with the good news, which is the gospel, that God had seen their affliction and desired to release them from their slavery, to lead them into a prosperous land which flowed with milk and honey. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all of mankind to be saved and come to the recognition of the truth. And so, following these events, the law of God marches to the king of Egypt, that is, the devil, and proclaims to him, "God demands that you let his people go." Now, the Jews would want you to believe that this proclamation concerns them and them alone, but we Christians will find that this proclamation concerns us as well, and in a much more significant sense, actually, if we look beyond the simple letter of the law. This proclamation has very much to do with us because it's fulfilled by us in the present day. Anytime a soon-to-be Christian receives the good news from the law and the teachers of the law, you should know that this is all spiritually playing out in that moment. This is the very moment that the law proclaims to Satan, God commands you to let his people go. And it's a powerful expression that perfectly exemplifies God's love for humanity. But if you were to question how exactly Israel can be God's people, even during their enslavement to Egypt, since we know that no man can serve two masters, then I'll attempt to provide a satisfying answer to the best of my ability. It's definitely true that, from a human perspective, at a single point in time, you can only be in servitude to either God or Satan, and not both at once. However, God's perspective is different from ours, and when he says, "Let my people go," he isn't speaking from our perspective, but rather from his own. So, I believe you may find the answer in what Paul says, actually. Those who he foreknew, he also predestined. But then Pharaoh indignantly retorts to the law, "Who is God that I should revere him?" If you can recall, the text said earlier that the king of Egypt did not know Joseph, and so it would follow that he would not know God, because no one knows the Father if they don't know his only begotten Son. But Pharaoh is so infuriated by this edict that he retaliates on the Israelites, who now desire to leave him for Moses, by imposing that just as many bricks before Moses arrived should still be made even now after he has arrived. Although the only difference is that the taskmasters should withhold the straw from the Israelites, whereas they were abundantly supplied with straw for this work beforehand. While it's God's desire for us to be made free from slavery to Egypt, it's the contrary with Satan. Satan has no intention of letting us go without a fight, and a rescue as dramatic as this requires a strong hand, a hand as strong as the Lord's. Now, it's a common occurrence in the emancipation from sin that a person should begin this process with great joy and excitement, in the same way that the Israelites were overjoyed at the arrival of Moses and Aaron. But it will always be the people who desire to escape from Satan that will be attacked by him the most fiercely. And what we have here is Pharaoh demanding the same number of bricks, which are sins, to be produced as before the Israelites had come to a full knowledge of the truth. And this is most certainly a miserable time for a person who receives the truth, because although they are aware of righteousness and sin, they still possess the same habits as they did before they knew righteousness and sin. So now the previous pleasures that were enjoyed in sin are taken away, and all that man is left with is a guilty conscience. As the Apostle Paul says concerning this period in time, "I wouldn't have known sin except through the law. I wouldn't have known about coveting if the law hadn't said, 'You shall not covet.'" But sin, taking an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me coveting of every kind. Apart from the law, sin is dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came to life, and I died. And this commandment, which was to result in life, proved to result in death for me. Sin, taking an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me, and through it, killed me. And all of this is spoken by Paul from the perspective of the Israelites at this moment in time, the belief that we were better off before we knew righteousness from evil. The straw was there to help the Israelites make their bricks with ease and comfort. But now the straw is taken away, and yet still, they're expected to produce the same amount of bricks as they were before. The straw then can be understood to be the pleasure that once aided us in our output of sins. But now that Moses and Aaron have arrived, we no longer find any pleasure in committing evil deeds as we did before. And yet, despite the fact that it has been taken away, Satan still demands that we continue to commit just as much evil as we had before the arrival of Moses and Aaron. It's for this reason that Moses says to God, "Lord, why have you brought harm to these people? Why did you ever send me? Ever since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done harm to these people, and you have not rescued your people at all." Again, I stress the fact that this is spoken not only from a certain perspective, but specifically a perspective in time. Because, of course, we know that this ends with Moses singing triumphantly, and he most definitely didn't feel this way at that time. The statement is completely true, but only true at a moment in time. Now, if it's true that God knows the future, then it follows that he would know that this emancipation was never going to be as simple as merely telling Pharaoh to let his people go, but that by doing this, it would cause retaliation towards his people. So why would God, knowing the future, waste any time participating in this back and forth between Pharaoh? And here's an even better question. Why did God, knowing the future, even allow the Israelites to be enslaved in the first place? He knew this was going to play out the way it did in advance, and yet chose a very specific time to do this when he did. Why? Well, these are the questions that the letter can't satisfy. As God himself said, "My thoughts aren't your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways." It must be, as Paul says, that these things took place as examples for our sake.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
But moving further along for the sake of time, the text says, "Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying, 'When Pharaoh speaks to you, saying, "Work a miracle," then you shall say to Aaron, "Take your staff and throw it down before Pharaoh, so that it may turn into a serpent." So Moses and Aaron came to Pharaoh, and so they did, just as the Lord had commanded them. And Aaron threw his staff down before Pharaoh and his servants, and it turned into a serpent. Then Pharaoh also called for the wise men and sorcerers, and they too, the soothsayer priests of Egypt, did the same with their secret arts. For each one threw down his staff, and they turned into serpents. But Aaron's staff swallowed their staffs. It's no arbitrary detail that God demands the staff be used when attacking Egypt. This staff was used to represent the cross, which would soon attack this present world. Just as the rod overcame Pharaoh, the cross of Christ conquers the ruler of this world, Satan. And the chief characteristic of the serpent is wisdom. As it says in Genesis, the serpent was more wise than any other creature of the field. And Christ himself tells us, "Be wise as serpents." And of course, we know that there are two main factions of wisdom, the wisdom of the world and the wisdom of God. The significance of that rod which became a serpent when it was thrown to the ground is that it prefigured the wisdom of Christ. But Pharaoh fights back with his own wise men, who produce their own serpents, which is to be understood as the wisdom of this world. Because of the fact that they can't peacefully coexist, a battle must take place between the serpents. Just as the apostle teaches, we don't wage battle according to the flesh. But the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying arguments and all arrogance raised against the knowledge of God. Now, make sure to catch the fact, though, that it isn't merely one serpent fighting the serpent of Moses, but Pharaoh had made sure to outnumber Moses by creating many different serpents. This isn't to say that Satan possesses a greater amount of wisdom than God does, but to represent the very many different sects of wisdom he created to overwhelm the one truth. And yet, despite this chaotic strategy, the text tells us Aaron's staff swallowed their staffs. Now, curiously, Moses chooses to render this sentence as Aaron's staff swallowed their staffs, as opposed to Aaron's serpent swallowed their serpents. This is to say that there is some connection between the serpent and the staff, that the staff is also a type of wisdom. Now, it's common knowledge that serpents are very crafty and cunning creatures, so the connection to wisdom in this case is very obvious. However, in the case of the staff, what is the connection to wisdom? Is there any natural relation between wisdom and a stick? No, because this prefigured an event in history that wouldn't happen until many centuries later, the crucifixion. Just as the rod, which is the cross, was cast into the earth, which is to say, once it was received by men, that same rod was then changed into wisdom. Wisdom that was so powerful that it devoured all the wisdom of the Egyptians, that is, of this world. As Paul also says, "We preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God." The foolishness of God is wiser than mankind, and the weakness of God is stronger than mankind. And concerning this, it's written in another place, "He catches the wise in their own craftiness." Now, moving along in the text, it describes a series of events which are referred to as the 10 plagues, And there is so much to be said about each of these plagues that a whole separate video could be dedicated solely to this topic. But for the sake of time, I will briefly go over the 10 plagues. I believe the overall event of the 10 plagues represent the transition from bad habit to good habit that Christ refers to in the parable of the wineskins, actually. No one puts a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, because the patch pulls away from the garment, and a worse tear results. Neither do men put new wine into old wineskins, otherwise the wineskins burst, and the wine pours out, and the wineskins are ruined. But they put new wine into fresh wineskins, and both are preserved. It must be remembered that Christ said this concerning his apostles, specifically in reference to their transition from the men they were before they knew him, and later into the men they were at the beginning of Acts. And likewise, it's very common that there's a middle stage for a man between the time he first comes to a knowledge of the gospel and the time he is finally baptized, and this would be referred to as the catechumen stage. And so, the plagues themselves could perhaps most easily be interpreted as a man's change in conduct, each plague serving as a rebuke of sorts. Which is to say, when the word and law of God are finally received, all of the individual things that the world was deceived with, they reprove the world with symbolic reproaches in the form of different types of animals, so that the world might learn the nature of its errors from the nature of the corresponding penalties. And there's so much more to say on this topic, but let's narrow in on the first plague specifically for now. Moses is instructed to wait until Pharaoh has arrived at the waters before confronting him. And it was the waters of Egypt which helped make it powerful. But as Christ says, everyone who drinks this water will still thirst. It's the great commission of the Christian and the law of God to go and confront the adversary at his waters and expose the waters of Egypt with that same rod, which had turned into a serpent, to the blood of Christ. That the blood of Christ should be so strong and so powerful that it overcomes the waters of Egypt, which were once desired, to the point that they are repulsive. Once our Egyptian waters have been consumed by the blood of Christ, let's be sure we don't return to the waters of Egypt for nourishment and life, but remain repulsed by them, finding their aroma to be not the least bit enticing, but completely offensive and undesirable. And concerning the charmers who turn some water to blood with their sorcery, these are the heretics, the wolves in sheep's clothing. Because although they should attempt to imitate the very same work of the Christians given to them by God, they do so through their own sorcery and ultimately serve Pharaoh as their king. And there are even deeper mysteries to be discovered concerning the water which was turned to blood, such as the blood found in the wood and rock, for example. But this will have to suffice for now. After having plagued Egypt with swarms of pests, diseases, hail with fire, and great darkness, all for the purpose of subjugation, this great battle between God and Pharaoh culminates in the final plague, the slaying of the firstborn. Here, the opposing wills of both God and Satan are contrasted. While Satan desired the death of the firstborn Israelite male for corruption and evil, God rather desired the death of all firstborn Egyptians for purification and justice. And it's no small detail either that the Israelites themselves were only saved by the blood of the lamb on their doorpost. Otherwise, the angel of destruction would have visited their firstborn too. And I expect the meaning of this to be discovered in what the Apostle Peter calls to mind when he says, "If even the righteous are scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner?" Now, it's only after all 10 of these long plagues have completed that Israel may finally set off to the promised land with the spoils of Egypt, just as Christ himself asserts to us when he says, "Unless one first bind the strong man, he cannot enter his house and plunder his vessels." So first, we must bind the strong man, who is the devil. We must go in to plunder his vessels, and to free the souls which he had possessed by deceptive fraud. When we have done this and have overcome him, we have stood, just as the apostle says, "Stand therefore, having your loins girded with the truth, and again, stand in the Lord and act like a man. When we have opposed him in this manner, that ancient and crafty contriver will at many times act as if he has been conquered and will pretend to yield, just as Pharaoh pretended to let the Israelites go many times before he actually did. And Satan does all this so that he might make us more neglectful in the struggle. He'll also feign repentance and pray that we depart, but that we not depart far from his domain. He wants us near himself to some degree. He wishes for his own ends that we do not depart too far. But unless we withdraw far from him and cross the sea of baptism and say, as far east as from west, he has removed our iniquities from us, we cannot be saved. And it was this great miracle, the crossing of the Red Sea, that proclaimed the good tidings of salvation by water. The people passed over, and the Egyptian king with his host was engulfed. And by these actions, this sacrament was foretold. Even now, when we Christians find ourselves in the water of regeneration, we are fleeing from Egypt, from slavery to sin and Satan. And in the crossing of the Red Sea, we are set free by God. But the devil and his servants who pursue us, they perish. And so, when we have been freed, it's very appropriate to sing a hymn to the Lord with joy and exultation, for he is glorious and honorable, because honor and glory are his forever and ever. Amen. Now, the text then relates to us that they came to Marah and could not drink from the waters of Marah because they were bitter. So he named the name of that place Bitterness. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And Moses cried to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, and he cast it into the water. And then the water was sweetened. Again, I continue to stress that if we choose to strictly confine ourselves to the letter of the law and refuse to pay any respect to the allegorical interpretation, which Paul makes numerous reference to.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
Then we will be assaulted by very violent questions like the following. Why would God, after having performed such powerful miracles, ordain the people of God to then immediately arrive at a place with such bitter waters and put them at risk from the dangers of thirst? Why was it ordained by God that the people should thirst in the very presence of an abundance of water? What about a tree would possibly make those same bitter waters suddenly sweet? If we understand that God had the ability to make the water sweet by his own power and didn't need the aid of a tree to accomplish this miracle, then why make use of a tree at all? And truly, all of these headache-inducing questions, which spring from the strictly literal reading of these texts, overwhelm my metaphorical reading palette with a taste I could only describe as bitter. If the law should only be understood according to the letter, then the law is bitter and is itself Marah. But if God should reveal a tree, which is the cross of Christ, and that tree be submerged into those bitter waters, it will result in those waters becoming sweet. Whenever we read the Old Testament, we should carefully avoid the bitter waters of Marah, which is the letter. But at every opportunity, submerge the knowledge of the cross of Christ from God into the Old Testament, so that it will become sweet for us, and that we might drink from it abundantly. After this, the text says that they came to Elim, and there were 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees there. Now, I would ask anyone who chooses to only observe the letter of the law and decline the allegorical interpretation.
See, this is not some kind of allegory.
Do you really believe that there wasn't any figurative reason for God having ordained for them to arrive at Marah before they would arrive at Elim? Why would an all-knowing God allow them to arrive at the bitter waters before arriving at sweet waters? Why not skip the bitter waters completely and have them only arrive at the sweet waters of Elim to begin with? If we're only going to follow the simple record of facts, then it doesn't edify us much to know where they arrived first and where they arrived second. But if we instead pry into the mystery lying hidden in these matters, we'll discover the order of faith itself. First, the people are led to the letter of the law. They can't withdraw from this while they remain in its bitterness. But when the law has been made sweet by the tree of life and is finally understood spiritually, Then they pass over from the Old Testament to the New, and come to the 12 apostolic springs, and 70 palm trees will be found there too. Because the 12 apostles weren't the only ones to preach the faith of Christ, but also 70 others who were sent to preach the word of God are mentioned. So it's not sufficient then for the people of God to drink the water of Marah, even though it has been made sweet, even though all the bitterness of the letter has been cast out by the tree of life and the mystery of the cross. The old document alone is not sufficient for drinking. They must also come to the New Testament, from which they are given a drink without hesitation and without any difficulty. Unfortunately, the Jews, even now, are still at Marah. Even today, they attend to the bitter waters, because God has not yet shown them the tree by which their waters might become sweet. Just as the prophet predicted to them, unless you believe, you will not understand. However, as we read further along here in the book of Exodus, it will become plain to see that just as the Bible provides us with numerous examples of how we ought to behave, it likewise provides us with many examples of how we shouldn't behave. The planet Earth itself actually similarly functions as a cautionary tale in this respect, that despite having been washed clean of its corruption in the flood, it then returned to its former state of corruption. And because of this, it is destined for fire. Likewise, the Jews at many points, following their emancipation, function as cautionary tales for us Christians. They warn us of the dangers that every born-again Christian is capable of falling into. When we observe the Jews complaining and saying things such as, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the pots of meat, when we ate bread until we were full," we should all understand that this is an example of how we should not behave. Because what they are doing is exactly what Christ said is completely unacceptable. No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of heaven. And so if we, as Christians, look back at our previous lifestyle with any kind of nostalgia or fondness, we are then the emancipated Israelites who desire to return to Egypt as slaves. As the Apostle Paul himself instructed us, nor are we to put the Lord to the test, as some of them did, and were killed by the snakes, nor grumble, as some of them did, and were killed by the destroyer. Now these things happened for their correction, but they were written for our instruction, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. However, after much complaining from the Israelites about food, God takes the opportunity to perform a sign when he finally feeds them. As he says to Moses in the text, "I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people will go out and collect it daily, that I may put them to the test, if they walk in my law or not. And it shall be on the sixth day, they shall prepare whatever they bring in, and it shall be double whatever they bring in daily." Now, anyone who has read the Gospels knows how to interpret the manna that came down to the Israelites from heaven, since Christ himself explains it to us in the Gospel of John when he says, "I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. But this is the bread that comes down out of heaven, so that anyone may eat from it and not die. I am the living bread that came down out of heaven. If anyone eats from this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I will give for the life of the world also is my flesh." However, there are things in the text that Christ chose not to elaborate on, such as why at certain times that bread from heaven would rot with worms, and why a double portion had to be collected on the sixth day. And it's these things we will attempt to understand with the tools of faith provided to us by Christ and his apostles. Now, to begin to understand all of this, we must first inquire into what the term manna even means. Thankfully, it's already explained in the text for us. When the children of Israel saw it, they said to one another, "What is this?" Because they didn't know what it was. So this bread from heaven, called manna, which literally means, "What is this?" is the nature of inquiry and learning itself. So every time we hear the law of God read, we should always be asking ourselves the same question. What is this? What does this mean? Why is this here? The manna itself can be understood as the teaching or doctrine from God, and also the good works we perform as Christians. Now these two interpretations, doctrine and good works, may at first seem unrelated and disconnected from one another in relation to the manna. But if you meditate on it, you will discover the connection. The manna which came from heaven for the Israelites is the divine instruction given to us as Christians by God. And as the Israelites consumed the manna for energy and life, we also consume the good teachings from God so that we might perform them and remain spiritually alive. But if anyone were to ask, how does doctrine and good works relate to Christ, who claimed to be the manna? Well, the answer is very simple. Christ not only spoke perfect sermons filled with great teaching, but also lived the perfect life for our instruction, that we might imitate him in our own lives. And if we live as Christ lived, then it's no longer us who lives, but Christ who lives in us. The text states that they all gathered the manna, some more than others and some less than others, which is interpreted to be the level of understanding which each individual person is capable of achieving, and also the amount of good works that each person is capable of performing. As Christ says, the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces, some 100, some 60, and some 30 times as much. And then the text relates to us how some of the Israelites kept leftovers from the previous day till the following morning, and it bred worms and stank. Now, this can be understood in two different respects, both simultaneously true. In the first place, if the good teachings of God be presented to a person at the improper time, it could very well be a stumbling block to that person, which may ruin their spiritual development, in the same way that the very nutritious manna from heaven can be turned to rot and breed worms if taken at the improper time. In the second place, anyone who heaps up manna, which is good works, for the following day, in those first 5 days, which is in this lifetime, is guilty of trying to store up treasure for themselves in this life, which is a fruitless effort that only leads to the works rotting and breeding worms. However, the text states that on the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily, and that on the seventh day, the leftover manna gathered from the previous day didn't stink, and neither was there a worm in it. Because if we store up treasure for ourselves in the next stage, which is the true Sabbath, it will be as Christ says, there moth and rust won't destroy. This is what Paul mentioned when he wrote to the Galatians, saying, whatever a person sows, he will also reap. The one who sows to his own flesh will reap destruction from the flesh, but the one who sows to the Spirit will reap eternal life from the Spirit. There's much more that could be said on the manna from heaven and other details surrounding it, but this will have to suffice for now. In the next place, we read that the people were thirsty for water, and they grumbled against Moses. The mistake of the Israelites wasn't that they had thirst, but specifically what they were thirsty for. They were thirsty for earthly things, and not thirsty for the things that God desires us to thirst for. As Christ reveals in the gospel, blessed are the ones who thirst for righteousness. They will be satisfied. The Israelites should have thirsted for justice and righteousness from God, not earthly water which doesn't satisfy. But not missing an opportunity to perform a spiritual sign, the Lord says to Moses, take in your hand your staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink. We know that the rock is Christ, as the apostle tells us. However, until the rock is struck by the rod, it won't produce water to the people. But when the rock was finally struck by the same staff used to perform plagues on Egypt, it produced a fountain of water. As Christ says, he who believes in me out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. When Christ was struck on the cross, he produced the fountains of the New Testament for us, which satisfied our thirst. If Christ hadn't been struck, the whole world would have died of thirst. And finally, we reach the last part of the book of Exodus that we will cover in this video, the battle with Amalek. Now, as the Israelites continued on in their journey to the land promised to them by God, it happened that Amalek came and fought against them. Now, because of the fact that we can't serve two masters, it is impossible to be at peace with both God and Satan simultaneously. And so as soon as we have made peace with God, we have declared war on Satan, and he has declared war on us. He and his army will try to stop us and prevent us from entering the land promised to us by God. However, it says that Joshua, who shares the same name with Christ and prefigures him in many ways, went out to fight Amalek. Because Christ is our advocate, He will be sure to go out and fight Satan, and he will lead us to victory over Amalek. But as if this wasn't already enough edification, the Lord adds another great sign to this battle against Amalek. The text says, "When Moses held his hands up, Israel prevailed. But when he let his hands down, Amalek prevailed." And Moses' hands were heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other. So his hands were steady until the sun set. And Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. We read here that God ordained the Israelites to prevail against Amalek only when Moses, who also prefigured Christ in many ways, would lift his arms up. And when his arms became heavy, they had to be fixed in place by other men. The truth of the matter is, it wasn't because of Moses' prayers that the people were victorious over Amalek, but it was because while the name of Joshua was at the battle front, Moses stood on the hill, forming the sign of the cross. And finally, the text then relates how Moses built an altar to the Lord and called the name of it, "The Lord is my refuge." Because with a secret hand, the Lord wages war upon Amalek to all generations. Now we know that neither today nor any time recently was God personally waging a war upon the same Amalek. So it follows that this can only be understood spiritually, which is to say that this allegory of the battle with Amalek is a timeless truth which is fulfilled every day by every Christian who draws near to God and is persecuted by Satan. But if we imitate Scripture by putting the name of Christ at the front of the battle and remember the sacrifice of Christ on the cross, we will prevail against Amalek. The cross of Christ empowers the defeat of Amalek in war for all generations. Amen.